Thank you for the opportunity to be in your presence this morning. It's a privilege to be alive again today. It's a privilege not only being alive, but existing and living in you. Father, we lift our voice to worship you and praise you for who you are in our life. There is none like you. Father, yes, there is people important in our life. People can do great things in our life, but there is no one like you. Because you are the master and the source of all life. For that reason, Almighty God, we thank you not only for our families, but also for our neighbors. We thank you for our friends and those we love who are still alive at this moment. It's not by power, it's not by might, but by your spirit you have done it, Almighty God. As we are standing here, God, I let your mercy and your favor be upon me and upon each and everyone so that we can hear from you in the mighty name of Jesus. As you promised that you're going to be with us wherever we are and you are faithful in your way. For that reason, I believe and I trust that you are already here. Even before we were here, Father, we're already here. Planning to do great things for your people. Planning to do great and a mighty thing. So that people may know that you are our God and we trust in you. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. It seems that like some people are not here. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
One man of God in South Africa is Bishop Jensen. When he always comes to Zimbabwe, those who are in Zimbabwe, they know him. A great man of God. And who can be mighty also, because, you know, in this world, when you have got, you are loaded, people will respect you as a man. He was loaded, a very loaded man, and he was working as an advisor in spiritual realm as the president of South Africa. That man always say that I and my God were the majority. Hallelujah. So we should, wherever we are here, one or two, as long we came here for divine purpose, we should feel as if we are many and we are the majority. Are we there? We'll continue with our topic of last time, the maturity, spiritual maturity. And we should understand that maturity is required to access, that we said last time. God requires maturity to access some kind of promises, some of his promises. As long as you are not yet mature spiritually, there is a things of God that will just be, you know, songs, the chorus, but never take place in your life. Unless you understand what the requirement is, and we should make it possible. So we should build our maturity. It's not God who should build our maturity. It's us. He has given us some token, some ability to be mature. Are we there? Hallelujah. And we also touched some areas. We said that many areas of our life should also grow mature. Are we there? So to such extent, we have no reason to bring excuse. As long as we have got Jesus, we have been saved, we should work upon our maturity. Are we there? And the Spirit of God and the Word of God is there to equip you to a next level. Hallelujah. Before I continue in my oratory, let us go in the scripture first. Our main verse is in 1 Corinthians verse 13. The Bible says, 1 Corinthians 13, verse 11. The Bible says, when I was a child, I spoke and thought and reasoned as a child. But when I grew up, I put away childish things. This is from New Living Translation. That was verse 11, verse 13. Therefore, three things will last forever. These three things will remain: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. Are we there? Three things remains. In everything that we do, in every situation, as a Christian, three things remains. There is faith, hope, and love. Brothers and sisters, the foundation of Christian life is faith. I'll repeat this. The foundation of every Christian life is faith. Without faith, you can't lie to me that you are a Christian, because you can be blowing and swing in a different direction. As long as you have no faith, brothers and sisters, don't lie to yourself and don't waste your time that you are saved. Am I making sense? So that's why the Bible says these three remains. We'll go deeper later on. Faith, hope, and love. Our second scripture gonna be in Daniel 5:16-17. Daniel chapter 5, verse 16 to verse 17. This is the King Belshazzar who took over from the King Nebuchadnezzar. I'm told that you can give interpretations and solve difficult problems. If you can read these words and tell me their meaning, you will be clothed in paper robes of royal honor, and you will have a gold chain placed around your neck. You will become the third highest ruler in the kingdom. 17. Daniel answered the king, King, keep your gift or give them to someone else, but I will tell you what the writing means. Are we there? The third scripture, Ephesians 4:11. Now these are the gifts Christ gave to the church, the apostles. An apostle is a gift to the church, not a title. Do you understand? To show around. The gift he gave to the church. Apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, and the pastors and the teachers. Their responsibility is to equip God's people to do his work and build up the church, the body of Christ. That's their responsibility. A responsibility to equip the church, to equip you and I, and build up the body of Christ, so that we should mature in everything that we do. This will continue until we all come to such unity in our faith and the knowledge of God's Son that we will be mature in the Lord, measuring up to the full and complete standard of Christ. So the purpose of all those, that to build us to become to the perfect stature of Jesus. We should come to the standard of Jesus Christ. That's why those gifts are in the church. Those people were gifted to the church, so that they should build you and I to become mature to the level of Jesus Christ. Then we will no longer be immature like children. We won't be tossed and blown about every wind of new teaching. We will not be influenced when people try to trick us with lies, so clever they sound like truth. Do you get that? I don't know if you understand the way I understand it. I'll repeat the last. Then we will no longer be immature like children. We won't be tossed and blown about by every wind of new teaching. We will not be influenced when people try to trick us with lies so clever they sound like the truth. Instead, we will speak the truth in love. So we'll stand on the truth. We'll stand on the word of God. How we can stand on the word of God when this gift in the church equips us with the truth of God. And then the Bible says, instead we will speak the truth in love, growing in every way more and more like Christ, who is the head of his body, the church. Amen. And let us read Corinthians, let us read first Philippians 2:12. Dear friends, you always followed my instruction when I was with you. And now that I'm away, it is even more important to work hard to show the result of your salvation, obeying God with deep reverence and fear. You get what it says? So, as a Christian, we serve God, we should work on our salvation trembling and with fear. So we work on our salvation. Our maturity, we should work on it. It's not God who should work on it, it's you and I. And he says, even if I'm not with you, you should work and show the result of your salvation. Timothy 6:12. 1 Timothy 6:12. Fight the good fight for the true faith. There is the true faith and there is false faith. Says, for the true faith, hold tightly to the eternal life to which God has called you, which you have declared so well before many witnesses. Brothers and sisters, we fight a good fight here, of fight of faith, so that we should capture, we should keep the eternal life. And let us finish now by Romans 8:38-39. You know that is a similar, a common scripture. And I'm convinced beyond any doubt, any shadow of doubt, he says, I'm convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears of today nor our worries about tomorrow, nor even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below. Indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, bless the reading of the word. Today we continue with our topic, the maturity. And especially as we said the last time, that maturity is required to access some God's resources. Maturity is a condition. Maturity is a prerequisite kind of requirement for you and I to move to a next level of victory, to a next level where a human being, an ordinary man, can do extraordinary thing. Brothers and sisters, we are ordinary people, but we have got an extraordinary God. And when he's in us, we can do beyond our ability, and the people can be amazed through what God is doing through our life. Hallelujah. Christianity is more than coming to church. Coming to church is very, very important. But Christianity is more than coming to church. Christianity is more than having a title in the church. Christianity goes deeper than what we think Christianity is. Am I making sense to somebody? So since we received Jesus, we have been given a very important and very, very, very great, a wonderful destiny. As long as you are in Christ, no matter your background, no matter who you are, educated or non-educated, poor or rich, brothers and sisters, we have got a wonderful destiny. Are we there? As long as you understand that, what the salvation brings to you, will never make jokes with your salvation. Is more. That's the most important thing that you should care about than your money in your bank, than any material thing. Being a Christian is greater than anything else. And I can tell you that that's the highest privilege in this world, being a child of God. Brothers and sisters, yes, you can be a minister, you can be anyone, but that's not a guarantee. We have seen a president who ended up, he was a president after he stepped down, he had been jailed, he became a prisoner. We know people, rich people, after a while they become poor. We know people who are notorious, well-known, famous people, but at the end of the day, they do suicide. All those things of the world, those material things, doesn't give the warranty of a great future. That's why we can understand, and those things have corrupted the mind of many people. Immature Christians are corrupted by material, by what they see. But Paul said we don't focus on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Because what is seen is for a temporary time, is for a short time. But unseen things that we cannot see, that we believe in, and that belief should be in Jesus. There is other people who believe in unseen things, but it's not in Jesus. Only in Jesus where you will never be disappointed. Hallelujah. Hope I'm making sense to somebody. Otherwise, it will make sense later on. Now, with a wonderful and a great destiny, but the easiest way the devil can destroy your destiny, brothers and sisters, is connect you with people who don't know God, people who doesn't fear God. Hello, 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 am I making sense? The only way the devil can derive you from your great destiny, can take you out of the will of God, is connecting you with people who don't know God. Brothers and sisters, I'll make this statement that no mortal man, no devil, no demon, as the Bible says, can destroy your destiny. The only person who can destroy your destiny is yourself. Oh, am I making sense? The only person, there is no devil, brothers and sisters, no demon. There is no man, powerful or no powerful, though no wizard or witchcraft that can take your destiny from you, the destiny from God from your life. The only person who can destroy your destiny, is you. Am I making sense? No, I don't know if I'm making sense. Hello? So never accuse any mortal man or the devil or anything or a wizard destroying your destiny or future. The only person, I'll repeat this, who can destroy your future is you. The Bible says, no man or creature in heaven or under earth anywhere that can separate us from the love of God. That the person who can separate you from the love of God is yourself. Especially with the choice that we do on a daily basis. Now, if I were to give somebody an advice, I would tell you to secure your tomorrow, to secure your destiny by hiding yourself in Jesus. Hello? If I were to give you an advice, I would tell you secure your future by hiding yourself in Christ Jesus. Amen. Value your tomorrow than now, than today's challenges. Every challenge is a visitor. Every problem is a visitor. Can I tell you? Brothers and sisters, nothing remains forever. Any problem that we are going through, any situation, is a visitor. Don't destroy your future because of today's. Many people don't sacrifice your tomorrow for the sake of today's pleasure. Brother, if you want to understand how the pressure of today can destroy your tomorrow, ask Esau. Ask him. He destroyed his future, his destiny, the birthright, but because of the soup. Talk to him. He will tell you how painful it is when you value the present than the tomorrow. It's painful. You may not understand it. After losing it, you understand it. If you want your business to be to prosper. If you want your family to prosper, your career to prosper, brother, you should put the first priority in your life, your relationship with God. Anything that you value, brother, should be connected to your relationship with God. And I can repeat this again, oh my God. If you want to prosper in any area, your career, your education, no matter in your business, then you should prosper your relationship with God. Otherwise, you labor in vain. And you are doomed to failure. Brothers and sisters, let me tell you that there is nothing that you can do or build without God that the devil cannot destroy. Hello? There is nothing in this life that you can build or invest in without God that the devil is not able to destroy. There is nothing. The devil. This guy that we sometimes we come here and jump. I kick the devil out. Brothers and sisters, saying it is easier, but kicking him out is very hard. Kicking this boy is very hard, and he's a bad boy. If I can tell you, if there is a bad boy in this world, the devil is one. This boy can destroy in a second what you have built for years without God. He can destroy anything. I mean anything. When I say anything, is anything. Can destroy your children, can destroy your wife, can destroy your husband, can destroy your marriage, can destroy your investment. That's why the singer said, I will always be under the cross. Because the only place where the devil cannot step in and destroy things is under the cross. But in your bank account, he can. Anywhere else, as long as you are not, your health, not, which is away from God, he can destroy it. Easily reach it and destroy it in 1 second. I'm not telling you. You can suffer the consequences for years, but he destroyed it in 1 second. Hello? Are we there? Hey! Nothing can separate us from the love of God. And God is faithful. Remember last time we said, he told Joshua, be strong and courageous. I'll be with you wherever you will be. Am I making sense? Did we read that last time? Joshua 1, should be 8 to 9. He said, be strong and courageous. God didn't tell him that I'll make you strong. He said, you should work on your maturity, how you can be strong. It's not God, it's not the Holy Spirit. It's you working out your muscles to be strong. Hello? And he says, as long as you are strong and you keep your position, I will always be with you. I will never leave you, I will never forsake you. And when God says something, he means it. It's not like you and I. We can have the will to do it, but not the ability. But the Bible says the one who is able to do beyond what we can ask, he's able. The main word there, the emphasis should be the one who is able. He has got the ability. You can't doubt the ability he's able to do. You understand? So you don't have to doubt about him because he's able. But sometimes we may have the will to do good thing, but we don't have the ability. Are we there? When he says, I will always be with you, then he means it. For sure, God will always be with us as long as we keep our position. Only mature people can keep their position. Immature people always sit on the fence, you know, on the edge. So, and he watches the circumstances. Christian, pagan, non-believer, there is more movement here, he goes here. You see? He says, Christian, more bullied here. Oh, no, I'm here. Are you a Christian? Now, they start first. Those people, they are very smart. Christianity is rubbish. Do you know the way they do things? I saw one guy in Africa on a video who is saying that Christianity is bullying to African belief, because in order to be accepted to be a Christian, you have to remove your culture, the way you have to clothe like Western, you have to be like a Western to be accepted as a Christian. So he was saying, because he had those feathers of the chicken on the head, so he was like showing how is it painful to be a Christian, you know? And they'll make those kind of statements showing you how Christian is rubbish. He's saying about the Western, but the Western now is refusing even Christianity. Christianity is now for African, because here, if you ask 100 people, 100 people, 98 will tell you God doesn't exist, and those kind of things. So they will show you that how horrible Christianity is. Doesn't give people freedom, doesn't give A, B, C, D. And then they will ask you, are you a Christian? Because they were on the fence, you will just jump on the side of not being a Christian. You see, and when you see where the people are praising, are jumping, a Christian here is more comfortable, you jump on the other side, you are a Christian. Brothers and sisters, only immature people can do that. But mature people will stand their ground no matter the consequences. Are we there? And especially with financial, you know, you want to be on the top to buy the most current cars, most houses. You want to be on top, you know, to be on current affairs, you know, the way we do. And they use money to manipulate you. People can compromise easily, can compromise and change their mind. Immature people can change any time. This man was called Daniel. He was called without knowing what was happening. And the king, Belshazzar, told him, look, Daniel, this is the situation here. There is something that is written on the wall there. I couldn't read it. And I called all my magician and diviners and all those people that you know, astrologers. No one could read it. But if you read it for me, came with promises. That's how the devil does. If you do this, I'll give you 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And it was great. The third highest ruler in the kingdom. And not the kingdom that you know. I can tell you the third ruler in the American rank. Do you understand? Not like Burundi, Congo, where there is, you never know if you wake up tomorrow. Here, they will give you the best jet, the best security, the best car, and it will be on TV, on social media. Samuel has become ABCD. These men were promised those kind of promises. And they said, if you do it, then I'll give you. Are we there? And in fact, the man was able to do it. Do you know the answer? What he said, King, I will read and give you the interpretation. But if your gift, give it to somebody else or keep it for yourself. How many people now? We preach not because God should be given the glory. We preach for material things. We preach to be known. We preach for ego interest. Things that should make me look big, known, famous. No one is preaching anymore to equip the church of God. A few people. Immaturity is not only in believers, is also in leaders. You can see maturity everywhere, in every corner. If the church is this status right now, in this situation, it's because of immaturity at every level. Brothers and sisters, let me tell you, the Bible says these three will remain. First, hope and love. Are we there? Now, when you have got faith in God, it will lead to hope. Are we there? The Bible says in 1 Thessalonians that God is just. He will pay back trouble those who trouble you. Do you understand? This is now the hope that we have. The hope that we have in every situation we are going through, God will pay back our enemies. Do you understand? God tell us, love your enemy. and pray for them. Do you know why God tells us to love our enemy and pray for them? Do you know why? He tells pray for them so that they should be saved. Because the situation, when God pays them back, it will be horrible. So he tells you pray for them because their reward is horrible. He tells you pray for them when I will pay back their trouble, when I will pay back what they are doing against you, it will be horrible. So pray for them. Have pity of them. Have mercy on them. Pray for them. Even though they think they have got the power to do so, but they are miserable, pray for them. They don't know what they are doing. That when they were persecuting Jesus, do you know what he said? Father, forgive them. They don't know what they are doing. Brothers and sisters, God doesn't... The Bible says, don't revenge, brothers and sisters, in Romans. Leave the revenge to God. Leave the revenge to the righteous anger of God. Do you understand? He says, leave it to him. He knows how to revenge that man. And he calls his righteous anger. Do you understand what that means? So God, he doesn't revenge. I'll make this statement clear. God doesn't revenge. God punishes. Hello? Revenge is some people have got the same level. But God punishes. And when he punishes, yes, people can see it. Ask the king, Nebuchadnezzar. Ask the king this young man, who this? The one who took over him. The one. Belshazzar. This man was playing with cup from the temple, the holy temple in Jerusalem. So that were used for the divine purpose. Do you know you are used for the divine purpose of God? Do you know that? You are a cup, you are instances in the house of God who are used for the divine purposes. And now this guy messed up with those cups. He had a big banquet, and he called wife, friends, and nobles around the kingdom, and they were drinking. And when they were drinking, he said, bring us those gold and the silver cups. We want to use them. Hello? Brothers and sisters, the devil is a liar. Sometimes the devil can try to destroy you, but he doesn't know who you are in his house. Brothers, let him try. Pray God will punish. Am I making sense? When you know your position in him, nothing can secure you. Mature people, they understand that the trouble comes to test their faith, but they are more than a conqueror. Christian, a real Christian, a mature Christian, give the devil the red card. Hello? Have you seen in the different game, when you are given a red card, what does that mean? Out of the game. You are out of the game. And not only out of the game and out of the stadium. You have to go out. Do you understand? It's not only out of the game, you're out. Real Christian, they give the devil a red card. No matter the situation you are going through, you tell him this is. Immature, they give the devil a yellow card. That, yeah, I can give you a chance and see how you behave. You know, but mature Christian, they give the devil a red card. There's no room for compromise. Immature, wisdom, they call it wisdom. Yeah, Christian wisdom. Sister, yeah, if this man can provide that, yeah, try him first to see how it goes. If this woman can do this, try. Brother, the devil is a liar, he will swallow you. I'll make this statement. A mature Christian knows that we fight in the fixed battle. Okay? A mature Christian knows that in every battle that we do is a fixed battle. Am I making sense to somebody? The battle that we go through, the challenges of life that we go through is a fixed challenges. So in other way, you are more than a conqueror. It will have been won before you started it. Hello? Are we there? That's why they will give the devil a red card, knowing that devil, you are a liar. What I'm going through is already fixed. It will never take me anywhere. Are we there? That when the devil attacked Job, it was already a fixed battle. The God told the devil, do everything, but don't touch his heart. It's a fixed battle already. There is nothing, there is some mark that the devil cannot cross. There's a red line he cannot cross. So you are more than a conqueror. So your victory is already declared before the devil attacks you. So no matter what you are going through, you are already a conqueror. Mature Christian. Immature will try to help God and to solve the problem. They'll bargain with the devil, they'll bargain with anyone. Let us solve the problem. But the reality is, brothers and sisters, trying to solve a problem without God breeds a greater problem. Trying to solve any issue, any problem without God, it leads to bondage. Are we there? Or put God aside and we can use our way, in our culture. Do you understand that? Yeah? Have you heard that? People, okay, I know you are a Christian, but in our culture, they take you from God, they bring you in the culture. Brother, culture will destroy you. Hello? Human blood doesn't create a family. The only blood that creates a family is the blood of Jesus. Human blood creates relationship. You are my sister, we are my biological, whatever. That's okay. But it's not your family. The real family comes from God. Have you seen people have been killed by their own brothers and sisters? Have you seen them? So when you see a Christian killing another Christian, he's not a Christian. He's immature. And when you are immature, you are not a Christian. Brothers and sisters, let me tell you, if you are immature, you never enter the kingdom of heaven. Immature people never enter the kingdom of heaven. We have to be clear of that. And we are not here. We are here to fight for a good faith, a good battle, so that we can capture the eternal life. We are not here to make games, to dance and make people sweat and we go home as if we are not doing nothing. We are here for a purpose and we do everything for a purpose. Hello? Now, faith will lead you to God. And God will give you some instruction. The instruction is already in the Bible. This instruction in the Bible will build up your hope. Okay? Am I making sense? So, faith, those three will remain in 1 Corinthians 13:13. These three, faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of all is love. Now, what comes here? What does that mean? And you understand God is what? God is love. Okay, God have no enemy. He loves everyone, and even those who are insulting them. Otherwise, if it was you, you know, if you don't, you know the issue in Russia now with Ukraine. Poland and this other country, Bulgaria, have been supporting Ukraine. The Russian government have cut, the supply of gas. Do you understand? Because you are not supporting me, I'll cut the gas. Imagine how the love of God is. Somebody who is insulting you day and night, you don't exist. He could have cut the, you know, the supply of bread and cut it. But the love of God, he gives the rain to righteous and unrighteous people, to evil and good people. So that's how the love of God. This is what we call love. The greatest of all is love. And we said last time, mature people, they don't offer advice, they offer love. Because the greatest, any advice you give me without love is an aggression, is an assault. But anything that you do in love, brothers, heals. Hello? Hallelujah. Love. Now it says, look, faith, as long as you've got faith in God, you trust God in everything. You believe he exists. He's the reward of those who seek him. And that will create the hope that God will never, is not a son of man to lie. He will never leave you or forsake you. That will give you the guarantee, no matter the situation you are in, God is always with you. But let me tell you, the presence of God doesn't take away storms in life. But the reality, what it tells you, that he will always be with you through the storms. Let me tell you, the storms can rage, but don't let it rage within you. Hello? It can be around, it can rage around you, around everything that you own, but don't let it rage in you. Don't let your heart be troubled. Do you understand? In the other way, what that mean? With all this hope that we have in him, these promises we have in him, so it gives us guarantee to such extent we can even love our enemy. Do you understand? So what that mean? If you are my enemy, you can't do anything to me because I have got the greater of greatest. God is with me. So I don't have your hatred, your envy, whatever, your jealousy, what you want to do, can't hate me because I have got hope in him. And that hope will make you the faith in God and the hope in God, both combined, will give you the ability to love unlovable. Making sense. Hallelujah. Because what you know, there is insurance that there is this man will take care. No, it's not my business. Hating you is not my business. Fighting you is not my business. The man I know, the one who's going to fight you. Hello? Amen. So mature Christian only can get to that level. Amen. Otherwise, you'll be tempted to fight yourself. And you're tempted to revenge because that's in human nature, to revenge. But when you know, I have got hope in him that you know, there is a hope to revenge. There is a hope to protect me. There is a hope to do this. So you don't bother who likes you, who doesn't like you, who wants to do evil or bad thing to you. You know the guy is taking care and he's my protector. Therefore, I'll love you no matter what. Mature people. Only mature can love their enemies because they have got faith in God and hope in God. So the three remains. And the greatest of all, love. Brothers. No. Love your enemy. You don't know what you do. Brothers and sisters. One guy was preaching in America. He was a neighbor of a great loaded family, and he was a very poor young man. The preaching, Jesus is the Lord. And that lady came walking his dog around, and he found that many preaching and the people listening to him. And he stood next to him and said, are you listening to what he's saying? Which God is he preaching? He said, if the God is preaching, even my dog cannot believe in him. Hello? What? Before he's preaching Jesus, and the person is standing next to him, saying that the God is preaching, even his dog cannot believe in him. If he wants the church to join, he will ask his dad. He knows a lot of churches around. Hello? The next day, the lady fell sick, taken to hospital. The doctors, the nurses around did whatever they can do. He was screaming for that man. Can you call me this person? Call me this person. And then I didn't know what was going on. So one of the people who knew the young boy, and it was on Sunday, he was at church, like Sunday like today. So they said, I know him. So he said, no, if you know him, he had been screaming, crying for him to be, to come. So they went to call that young boy. The boy came, a poor person looking for the transport to get to the hospital. When he was just going up the stairs, the lady died. And when he turned up, are you so-so? Says, yes. Oh, my God, he had been crying for you. The man could understand what happened the day before. Brothers and sisters, no matter those who despise you, God will pay back their despise. Those who trouble you, God will pay back their trouble. I can assure you, we are in the right boat. The God that we are serving here, we may look feeble, poor, no people around, but our God is greater than anything. Amen. And I can assure you are not wasting your time. You reap on due time. On due time, you reap. You reap what you have been sowing in this church. I can assure you, brothers and sisters, we are not saving in vain. It may look in the eyes of people that we are doing nothing, but we have got testimony from different people, people who don't know us. Imagine you are just greeting, somebody is talking to somebody and he gives you a phone to speak to this person and he talks about this church. He doesn't know me, I don't know him. He doesn't know that we have got a church here, but he talks about this church. It may look small, but bigger in the eyes of God. Hope implies a level of sanctity, that of insurance that will receive God's good no matter the situation. No matter the storm, there is a sanctity, there is insurance, a guarantee that will receive God's good no matter. That's hope. And when hope speaks, the doubt and the enemy, it zips the enemy mouth. He can't speak anymore. Brother, the big problem is when we doubt. The devil can have some begging around your situation. But when the hope speaks that there is a guarantee no matter what, no matter what I'm going through, no matter the devil attacks, that there is a guarantee in him that I'll receive my reward. No matter what the devil is doing, my reward is already there. In other way, the baseline of every faith, of every belief, is hope. Hope will stabilize your mind, your thoughts, your emotion, because you know for sure this is a fixed game. No matter what the challenges will one day finish. And you keep your faith in him. So hope will make you that to stabilize the situation. And faith gets its root from, hope gets its root from faith. Hope is rooted in faith. And faith breeds hope. Hope breeds, both combined breeds love. Because I believe in God, then hope gets his residence, permanent residence in faith. God is there forever. He does everything. He cares about me. He takes care. No matter what, he will never leave me or forsake me. He will never put me on shame. He will never A, B, C, D. That when those things happen, and the devil can... sometimes he can bring storms and put sands and whatever dust on you, but you're still hoping in him that this will go away one day. Then, brother, you don't have to know who's doing this, who's doing what. So your only issue is to love them. And that force doesn't come from you. it comes from God. Because the Bible says in Galatians 1, Christ in us, hope of glory. So as long as he's in you, he will give you that hope. And as long as you are in hope with him, there is a glory no matter what. Only mature Christian can go to that level. What can I talk about? There is a lot to talk about. But let me go quickly through a few things. I'll go quickly, very, very quickly, in order to finish on. Some sign of spiritual maturity. Mature Christian receive the truth of the gospel as it has been passed down through the scriptures. A true Christian, a mature Christian, he will never select this, especially, you know, immature, if you touch his weakness, he will hate you. He will not love even your preaching because it touches his weakness. Mature Christian never repent. Never confess their sin. They confess other people's sin. He's doing A, B, C, D. He never confesses his own sin. Brothers, mature, start confessing your own sin. Immature Christian, you hear them confessing failures of others. They will never confess their own sin. Because as long as you ask for forgiveness, brother, have you wronged someone in life? Have you wronged someone? She's here. Okay. You know, when you go and ask for forgiveness, do you know what happened? The other person in Africa, the way we do, Sasa ulijua makosa yako. Now you understand your weaknesses now and your mistakes. So instead of saying, by the time you open your mouth, I'm sorry for a, Maraba uni mungu sasa. This is God now. I'm translating. Now you can understand your mistakes. So brothers and sisters, as long only mature people can ask for forgiveness. Because by asking for forgiveness, you will be humiliated. More humiliation. The guy instead of, and immature, you know, I just come here to ask for forgiveness. Now what are you bringing around this again? If it's that, I'm going. Do you understand? I just come for, why bring this around? Immature. But the mature one, I want to get healed. That's what I'm here. Do what you can do. Yeah, take whatever you can take on my wound. I want, what brought me here is not you. It's not your word. I want to get healed. No, that's only my issue. That's why I'm here. A mature person, you'll take like 30 minutes, 3 minutes, talking about how bad he is. That's why I came here. I know my weaknesses. That's why I'm here. Yeah, I forgive you, but don't do it again. Hello? Hello? And he makes himself holy as if he didn't do anything. So, do you know the mature one? He says, don't do it again. Immature person also will. So, how come about you? You won't ask forgiveness too? Immature people are dealing here. But immature person, we just keep it quiet. It's about him, it's not about you. As long as you feel comfortable, that's up to you. I'm here for the sake of my soul. It's for my future, it's for my destiny. Immature people. Do you know about so immature? Don't even respond. Keep quiet. Confessing other people's sin. He's perfect. Oh. Mature people, they watch their words and when to speak and when to keep quiet. They know words are not just words. Words have got power. Words can destroy your future, can build your future. And especially don't speak when you are ahead. Brother, don't speak. I'll say that. Keep quiet. Because by speaking in that situation, you create more wounds. Keep quiet. You look small, but you are more. You are greater. Let those who think they are greater to speak impose their order, keep quiet. By keeping quiet, you are protecting yourself and protecting other people. And you are protecting yourself from repenting tomorrow and asking for forgiveness because you didn't say anything. Brother, no one will quote you wrongly, your silence. As long as you are silent, you are silent. They watch their words. They watch over their mouth. And believers, immature, they will talk up to tomorrow. Mature Christians grow less depending on themselves and men. But immature, they grow more depending on themselves and their connection and relatives. Are we there? Brothers and sisters, cursed is a man who put his trust in a man, another man, and who put away the ways of God and think by his connection, by his status, education, he can make it through. Brothers and sisters, as we said before, there is nothing you can build without God that the devil cannot destroy. I would repeat this. There is nothing that you can build without God that the devil cannot destroy. Because anything you build with God, God will put always insurance around it. He told Abraham, leave. And the one who, anyone who will bless you, I'll bless him. Anyone who will curse you, I'll curse him. In other way, God will always watch because he never sleep or slum. God will always watch upon his promises in your life to such extent to make them, to fulfill them. Until they come to pass, God will never have a rest. And therefore, only God who doesn't sleep, who can protect you when you are sleeping. Other people, do you know? Another man said, a high risk in life is to sleep. Hello? A high risk in life is to sleep. What about if you sleep and don't wake up? Do you understand? That's a high risk we do. Not driving cars. Sleeping. What about if you don't wake up? One man was told that he will die. He was the president of Burundi. A diviner came and told him that in 100 and so days, he will die. He was the second president after the first elected, democratically elected president. That night he didn't sleep. That death he was told that he would die, the guy didn't sleep. He was waiting to see how the death will come. Hello? Hello? Are we there? But the way, finally he died in a car, in an airplane crash. That's how life is without God. The devil, I always tell people, the devil can borrow you the ladder to go up, and by the time you go up, that he'll take it. You go up, ba, you think you are making it. How come I'm going for the ladder and I still need to go down? So he never turned back. That's how the devil does. Brother, you wonder how should I go down? How should I hide my A, B, C, D? No possibility. The devil have taken, the guy have taken, the bad boy have taken the ladder. The devil is a bad boy. Don't let him twist your mind. Don't allow him. By you give him a finger, he takes the whole hand. You just give him to sit on the chair, he takes the whole house. The devil is a bad boy. Never allow him. As parents, you have got 5, 10 children. He can take this one. Oh, he takes. You think you are giving him now? This is over. Take that one. He will take all of them. As long as you just give him an opportunity, he will destroy you. The guy is a destroyer, is a killer. He isn't expecting that. The only way, build up your faith in God. Strong Christian, they make effort to build on their faith. Brother and sisters, there is a level of faith. Mature Christian, they always go to the next level of faith. As we have got challenges in every area, there is also faith in every area. Hello? We have got challenges in every area. We have got faith in every area. We should build up on our faith. But immature will always blame God, will always blame the pastor. And he will always tell you I have to look for another church. They think there is more churches that can build them up. No, you build yourself up. Are we there? You build yourself up. When you are mature, you understand that this business is about me and God. It's not about other people. It's not about the environment. It's about you. Mature people, they know what to put on as a cloth. Immature, they tell you that God just look on the heart, not on the on the outward. He looks on the heart, inner heart. Brothers and sisters, let me tell you, do you know what made the people of Sodom and Gomorrah to know those angels were strangers? Do you know what? They look like them. They walked like them. They could speak their language. But what made them look different was the way they were clothed. And the men in Sodom, they said, people said, which kind of people can wear long clothes like this in this city? Said, no. Because everyone was half naked in Sodom, selling whatever can be sold. So when they saw them, they said, watch them closely. Where are they going? They realized they were going to Lot's house. And they went there. They said, these guys, because they don't know the dressing code here, we'll show them. Give us to them. We'll show them what we can do. And they will go testifying that how tough the men of Sodom and Gomorrah are. You understand the old people, what they meant by that. And the guy said, no, I have got my virgin daughter that can offer them. They said, no, out of fashion. You know, so these things that we always hear on TV, men, whatever, they have been there for long. That's why the Bible says there's nothing new in this world. Watch after yourself, brothers and sisters. Things that are attracting people, it's just death. They have killed other people before. Hello? Nothing new. Mature people will always see other people greater than them. They will put the interest of other people above their own interest. Brothers and sisters, as long as you put somebody's interest above yours, God will care about your interest. Are we there? Love is not only giving people lift. Love is something that we always speak around. Love is something that we should practice on a daily basis. Hello? Hallelujah. Amen. Love should be something we should practice as a Christian. Buy a t-shirt to a brother. Buy something brother, I've seen people here. Oh, I found this. Yeah, people were selling this, and I found that maybe I should buy this for you. We have seen people buying other things to other people here. I'm not mentioning people's names. That's how love is. Hello? Mature people will always express what Jesus said. Love each other, and people will know that you are my disciples. Mature people only can do that. Immature will criticize everyone in the church except himself and, or herself and the devil. They will doubt everyone except himself and the devil. They have got an issue for everyone except the devil and himself. But other people, ugly, bad, only the devil, he will never mention about the devil. At the end of the day, blame God. Hello? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Brothers and sisters, when we talk about Christianity, growth, that is, we grow. And we grow in our Christianity spiritually, physical growth and spiritual growth. So when I'm talking about spiritual growth, I'm not talking having beers and whatever, and put on age. You can have the old age that you need, but you are still a baby in Christianity. You can stay in the church for 30 years, but you are still a baby. So in order to grow up in this kingdom is a personal effort that you can make. You can be surrounded by babies, but you are a grown-up person. Let me even tell you, your pastor can be a baby. He can be preaching as a baby preacher, but you are a grown-up Christian. Am I making sense? A grown-up believer. So let us stand on the word of God. Let us stand on our promises. As the Bible says, the three will remain. The faith in God is very, very important. That is the foundation of Christian life. Brothers and sisters, there is nothing you can achieve in this kingdom without having faith, without believing in God. That's the foundation. And by entering the kingdom, there is a promises. There is what we call here, I remember when I was asking for citizenship in Australia, they said there is privilege and right, you know? So there is a right and a privilege. Brothers and sisters, as long as you enter the kingdom by believing and trusting in God, there is a privilege. The privilege you have got security, protection in every area. And that creates your hope that this man is on business. And now it gives the both combined, it will give you the ability to move and act in love. And love is an expression of mature Christian. Hello? Love is an expression of mature Christian. When you see somebody loving people without distinguishing them, you should understand this is a mature Christian. Somebody insults you, you come tomorrow, you offer him a cup of water. Do you need this? That you should be mature. And unless you are mature in the Lord, you can destroy. You know these people in the world, do you know? You hear somebody, I have divorced 10 times, 5 times. Do you know the problem is not the people around you, it's about you. How do you behave? As long as you have got these two in you, you will act in love. Brothers and sisters, let me tell you, love can do what counseling cannot do. Love can bring people closer than material thing. Love speaks louder than anything else. Hallelujah. Am I making sense? I'll give you an example of a certain lady who were about to get married, but he was a smoker. So they organized the wedding. Then the husband changes the mind. He said, "No, there is no way I can marry you with your smoke around." The lady said, "What?" He said, no, there is no way." The lady had already tried several times to leave tobacco, but she couldn't. But one that time when the husband said, "I have I have given up the plan to get married because of smoke. The woman said, from today, smoke, I gave up to you. Because of what? Love. What the strategies and the counseling couldn't do, love did it. Because he loved the man, he said, I'll give up to this. And when we love God, there is the thing that we have to put away. As this man said, when I was a child, I speak as a child. When I was a child, I thought as a child. I behave as a child. But when I grew up, I put away childish things. Brothers, because of God, and we know our childish things that we do. We all know it, but we pretend as if we don't know it. Brothers, there is childish things that we do. Brother, if you love God, you will put it away. Hallelujah. May the Lord bless you.